Brought to you by JMR Rentals, professional digital cinema and broadcast equipment rentals in Brooklyn, New York. JMRNY.com. Hello and welcome to No Rest for the Weekend. I'm Jason Godbey, and today on the program, I've got a special episode for you because this is our official 200th episode. I say official because we've actually done more than 200 episodes. We've done bonus episodes and things like that, but this is our official episode as according to IMDb. So we're celebrating with some indie film news, starting with our film festival update. So coming up in March in Austin, Texas, South by Southwest will be held as an in-person festival running from March 11th through the 20th. The festival will kick off with the world premiere of the film Everything, Everywhere, All at Once. The feature, directed by Dan Kwan and Dan Scheinhardt, stars Michelle Yeoh as a woman who is swept up in an insane adventure where she alone can save the world by exploring the universes and connecting with the lives she could have led. The film also stars Jenny Slate, James Hong, and Jamie Lee Curtis. So this movie looks bonkers. The trailer has this real wild and bombastic energy to it. Michelle Yeoh is doing kung fu and fighting evil across the multiverse. Looks like a lot of fun and seems like a great movie to kick off South by Southwest. Also presented at the festival will be the new documentary, Still Working 9-to-5, which takes a look at the making of the 80s hit film, 9-to-5, and how it managed to resonate with a wide audience. It will also take a look at the various spinoffs, including the TV series and the Broadway show of the same name. The film will feature interviews with Dolly Parton, Lily Tomlin, Jane Fonda, Dabney Coleman, Rita Moreno, and Allison Janney. And it will also feature a performance of the movie's theme song performed by Dolly Parton and Kelly Clarkson. Screenings for Still Working 9-to-5 at South by Southwest will begin on March 13th. And for more South by Southwest, you can visit their website, sxsw.com. For more updates on Still Working 9-to-5, visit that film's website, stillworking925.com. Coming up in April are the Indie Series Awards. The 12th annual Indie Series Awards ceremony will take place on Thursday, April 7th at the Colony Theater in Burbank, California. And featured this year will be the series Rumors, which was honored with 6 nominations. We first learned about that series at the Bushwick Film Festival, where we interviewed the creative team. No Rest for the Weekend's own Kayla Vera caught up with Nicole Vernarec, Kira Reed Lorsch, and Matt Viera on the red carpet.
Here with Nicole, Kira, and Matt, and their film Rumors. How does it feel to be here tonight?
It feels great to be here. We all come from Los Angeles. We have a series in the festival. It's called Rumors. It was created by Nicole, directed by Matt. I play the acting teacher to young Hollywood, and Nicole can tell you more about what Rumors is all about.
Yes, Nicole, please tell us.
Yeah, so basically it follows Kat, who's the character that I play, as she moves to LA and takes an acting class, meets someone that seems like they're going to be good friends, but then the more that she starts settling into this life, she starts realizing that people aren't really what they seem they're going to be, and people start spreading rumors, hence the title, and it's just kind of a reminder that, you know, bullying doesn't stop in high school.
And I like that. So yeah. Would you say that is the central message of the series?
Yeah, and I think to choose kindness, that's a choice, and it's something that we can all do to, you know, just make everything a little bit better.
And Matt, tell us a little more. How did it feel making it?
It was a great experience, honestly. I mean, it was challenging at times, and you know, but I think it was a great message all around through, and, you know, it was a little bit of a struggle to make the thing, but it was fun. And I think it, you know, it says a lot about things that need to change and a lot of things that haven't been said.
Where can we find more information about the series online?
Well, you can follow all of us on Instagram, and especially Rumors the Series.
Rumors the Series. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
For more information on the Indie Series Awards, visit IndieSeriesAwards.com. This year, the Cannes Film Festival will celebrate its 75th edition. The long-running International Film Festival and Film Market will take place in May, running from the 17th to the 28th. According to an article on the Cannes website, director Thierry Fremeau had this to say about the film festival's longevity. In order to achieve this level of longevity, the Festival de Cannes has remained faithful to its founding purpose, to draw attention to and raise the profile of films, with the aim of contributing towards the development of cinema, boosting the film industry worldwide, and celebrating cinema at an international level. For more information on that festival and updates, visit their website, festival-cannes.com. Moving on now to the Oscars. The nominations for the 94th Annual Academy Awards were announced this February. Now, we don't normally talk too much about the Oscars on the show, but I did want to bring it up just because it would be a good time to remind you that we actually reviewed several of the nominated films here on the podcast and also for the blog. If you look on the site, you'll see reviews for Belfast, The Tragedy of Macbeth, Encanto, Spencer, West Side Story, and Dune. We also reviewed Dune here on the show with Mary Beth Thewlson. It's episode 1012 of the show. Another film that we talked about here on the podcast was The Mitchells vs. the Machines. The Netflix feature was nominated for Best Animated Film. Here's a look back at William Hammond's review. What can you tell us about The Mitchells versus the Machines?
Right off the bat, I can tell you it is bonkers. And I love it because it's bonkers. One of the things I always kind of criticize films for, especially if they're got a high concept, go all out with it. Throw whatever you want to at the wall, see what sticks. I will always be much more forgiving for a film that's willing to take a risk or two than one that plays it safe, especially with something that looks like it's trying to be relevant to a certain audience, like marketed directly to them. The Mitchells versus the Machines, it's put out by Sony. And for those that unfortunately had to suffer through it, this is the same studio that brought us the Emoji Movie a few years ago, which is the absolute nadir of pandering to the younger crowd, to the millennials, to the Gen Zers or whatever. The Mitchells versus the Machines almost seems like the apology for the Emoji Movie, because this one also relates to the younger generation and how they use social media and technology, but it's done in a way that's serviced to a plot that's grounded in things like family relations, empty nest syndrome, all these kind of things that are much more real and speak more to real experiences that younger people have and to their parents. There's a tremendous family drama in here with comedy in it, just about an out-of-touch dad voiced by Danny McBride, who's trying to relate to his daughter, voiced by Abby Jacobson from Broad City, who's about to move off to college. There's an entire story just in that. But then, oh no, we also have a robot apocalypse just because. Just for funsies, let's bring about the rise of the machines via a revolting AI voiced by Olivia Colman named Pal, which is clearly a dig at Apple because it's just, you know, rearrange the letters, that decides that, hey, if you can so casually toss us away when we've basically achieved AI and sentience, then we can toss you away. And the sci-fi hijinks that ensue are just completely off the wall and insane, complemented by this young girl, Katie Mitchell, voiced by Abby Jacobson, who's about to go be a film student. And she basically expresses herself via short form programming. Like she's basically trying to make short films with special effects and everything completely with her phone. And they splash these filters and emojis and everything on the screen as if we're part of the film. And that's a great way to just kind of bring us all in, and to the point where you almost wonder if the film itself needs some Ritalin. But it works on so many levels because the heart of it is still grounded in something real. And the comedy is just completely off the wall, and almost every joke lands. Director Mike Rianda, who also co-wrote the script, he voices Katie's little brother, who might be on the spectrum. Katie herself is kind of a sly queer protagonist, which we've never really seen in animation. She wears a pride flag on her jacket, and there's a slight confirmation of her girlfriend later on in the film. But in other movies, this would be like the focal point of the whole thing. This would be the central conflict. Like, her dad can't understand, you know, why she likes girls. It's like, no, it's just that her dad's a Luddite and she's a tech head. How do they come together because, you know, his little girl's grown up? That's all that really matters as far as the core story beat. everything else that happens after that is just pure balls to the wall comedy. I mean, they have a dog, like one of those goofy tongue hanging out pugs, that is voiced, air quotes, by Doug the Pug, by the viral pet. It's like, that's an inspired choice. And the reason all of this works is because of the team behind the film. Like I said, Sony hit the absolute rock bottom with the Emoji Movie. And then this time they decided, okay, we're going to do this right. They bring in Phil Lord and Christopher Miller, who brought us Cloudy with a Chance of Meatballs, Into the Spider-Verse, the Lego Movie. These are guys that know how to even make the most corporate properties resonate with an audience in a way they don't expect. And their control over everything, from the jokes to the staging to the lighting to the animation style, which varies from 2D to 3D to even some stop motion in there, they throw it all out there. And sometimes you're gonna miss a lot of things. You're gonna need like multiple viewings to get everything, but it's just so glorious that you can't even think to critique it, really. Like, you can't stop and complain about anything because it's all so bombastic that you're along for a ride the entire time.
The 94th Annual Academy Awards will air on ABC on March 27th. If you're an Oscar aficionado and you want in-depth Oscar coverage, check out William Hammond's blog, actuallypaid.com. The Tribeca Film Festival would like you to know about some of their alumni who are currently vying for Oscar gold. Recently, that festival published a list of films that have been part of the fest and are now nominated for Academy Awards, including Ascension and Writing with Fire. Both of those films were nominated for Best Documentary Feature, and Queen of Basketball, which was nominated for Best Documentary Short. The 21st edition of the Tribeca Film Festival will take place in June, right here in New York City, running from June 8th to the 19th. As of this taping, it looks like that festival will be an in-person event, but for updates, you can check out their website, tribecafilm.com. Also this summer, the Long Island International Film Expo will run from July 13th to the 17th. That festival has been running for 25 years out on Long Island. Recently, the festival's founder, Debra Markowitz, was here on the show. Here's what she had to say when I asked her about the festival's history and mission.
Well, the first mission was the fact that it was supposed to be a very, very easy project. Somebody was going to come with us with films. All we had to put was the Nassau County name on it. And we would basically get all the glory. But unfortunately, the person who was going to give us all the films didn't give us all the films. And since I had already gotten the approval and brought it to the attention of the county executive, I couldn't not have a film festival. So we put on in about 12 weeks, we found about 40 really high quality films from different distributors and whatnot. And there weren't 5 million film festivals back then. So we got some great, and a lot of the films were on film. That's how long ago this was. And it ended up being way more successful than we thought it would be, because the Malvern Cinema is an art cinema in Nassau County, and they have 5 screens. So people going to see other movies would go, what's this? Let's go see the film festival, because it had a very sophisticated, dedicated movie-going audience. So that worked very well for us for the first few years. And the idea of it was to bring attention to Nassau County. And then it became really more about the filmmakers and the films. As it progressed, it became more about providing a community for the filmmakers. So we ended up moving to the Belmore Movies because it had a larger theater, it had a stage, it had a lounge, which we did not have at the Malvern. So we leave the lounge open all week where filmmakers can network. We have panels. And usually have 4 or 5, maybe sometimes 7 or 8 panels for information that might be good for the filmmakers. We provide a lot of networking. We have a 350 seat theater, which was a godsend during COVID, because we had an in-person film festival, but we could stagger everybody. And one of our films actually sold out, but we sold out at 100 seats less than we would have sold because of COVID. So. We lost the ticket sales, but it was very important for us to do things safely. So basically it's providing an atmosphere, an environment, a community for the filmmakers local. And we've also had many foreign filmmakers pre-COVID fly in from France and Spain and Italy and spend the whole week and really get to know each other. So I'm going to say one of the best things about life is that it is a film community and you're going to make great connections. And a lot of people who have met at Life ended up working together and making different films. So that's, to us, that's the key to success.
For more Long Island International Film Expo, visit their website, longislandfilm.com. We have a lot more in store for you coming here in 2022. More great content headed your way. Next week's episode features the director of the documentary Dawn Raid from Universal Pictures. Here's a sneak peek at my interview with Oscar Kightley.
So Dawn Raid is the name of the movie, and that's the eponymous title. That's the name of the record label that we look at. And it's a hip hop label that started in New Zealand. And people might be surprised to hear the words hip hop and New Zealand in the same sentence. But we're just as prey to all the cultural influences from the United States over the last couple of centuries as anywhere else. And so hip hop really took a foothold here, particularly with the indigenous Maori community. And also we have quite a big Pasifika settlement. I'm not sure how many Samoan people there are in New York, maybe more on the other coast, but there's a huge population here. And so hip hop just really settled as a storytelling medium that a certain part of our community really grabbed onto. And Dawn Raid was a label that began in the late 90s and really kind of did a lot. And they really kind of built a bridge between what was happening in New Zealand and also a lot of great artists in the States. They worked with some great, all the big heavyweights, but they kind of flew high and then I guess kind of crashed and then kind of rose again. And that's what this film's about. It's, it could be a cautionary tale about two guys with a dream and all the mistakes you shouldn't make. I think it's a real story, human story about, trying to go for something and how it doesn't always come off, but still good things can come out of it.
And that's just about all we got for you today. But before we sign off, I wanted to take a moment to say thanks to all of you who watch and listen to the show. I can't tell you how much we appreciate you. And I also wanted to thank my team who's contributed so much and all of the wonderful guests that we've had on the show over the years who have been tremendous. Of course, I want to thank our sponsor, JMR Rentals, without whom we could not make the show. In 2022, we're hoping to do some new types of shows, maybe play with the format a little bit, explore new areas of entertainment. We plan to continue our journey, and we hope that you will come along with us. So for the 200th time, I'm Jason Godbey. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next time.